Really? God said to give everything that's in your purse. All right, now. Look, she's looking. She's looking, too. She's looking. She's taking stuff out of her purse now. You better pass a bucket over there. Now, what it meant was, with the social status that we have as king and queen, here you were without your symbolism of what you wear on the outside to show everybody who we are. You took off your stuff, your kingly robe, and you were dancing and shouting and praising and worshiping with the common folk. Oh, didn't you look wonderful there in front of your handmaidens and your servants? She was mocking him and didn't even realize that his worship was going up to the Father, but she was sitting there thinking that their worship was being taken away from her. Because he's not wearing the king's robe. People knew he was still the king. People still followed him and knew he was still the king. But the thing is, because she didn't know and wasn't secure in who she was, she needed him to have all that outward appearance. Read the last verse. Somebody got that there? What does that say? Anybody?
Therefore, Michael, the daughter of Saul, had no child until the day of her death.
Now, I'm not trying to belabor this, but listen. Whenever you start being judgmental and start persecuting people that truly are of the Lord, you will have a barren spiritual life. That's all right, it might be the Lord. Tell him we said hello. I'd like to say only in my services, but it seems to be only in my services. Crazy, wild, off the wall stuff. I don't think we've ever had a cell phone go off, especially a pastor's wife. And she's still answering it. I ain't got no friends. Yeah, especially him. Yeah, thanks for calling, Derek. Good Lord. Mom, why are you out so late? It's Friday night. What are you doing in service? It's late. He's so funny. Love Derek anyway. But here's what's going on now. She started persecuting his act of worship to the Lord. Was David blessed? Come on, say yes. Was David powerful? Yes. Did David make mistakes?
Yes.
Was he forgiven?
Yes.
Did he turn his life around?
Yes.
Was he still a great leader?
Yes.
What did Acts say? He's a man after God's own heart. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. Who said that? God. He's a man after my own heart. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
But when somebody starts to persecute you, love them. Pray for them. Walk through it. Because you don't want to become barren spiritually with them. One last thing, and we're closing. Acts chapter 16. Have you gotten anything out of this tonight?
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. You cannot know this God and not worship Him. My goodness, I just felt the anointing just surge through this place. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. Would you come, Brother Heath, and begin to play the entertainer? Sorry. Peace that passes all understanding. You're so good, God. So good, God.
Come on. Your personality was meant to
use your voice. And everything has breath, praise the Lord. It didn't say silently. Actually, Psalm 35, I believe it's around the 27th verse, says, let them shout for joy and favor my righteous cause. You never have to find anybody, and you read that verse, you will find a church that believes and does the Word of God. As soon as you say, let them shout for joy, let them, are people trying to keep them from shouting? Let them shout for joy, because I want to shout. I've got to shout. My shout's got clout, and I've got to get it out. Come on. I gotta shout. That's not trying to get walls down. I gotta shout because walls are already down. So the prisoners heard him. Something funny happened. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prisons were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and every single one's bands were loosed. Not only will worship keep you free, you not holding back your worship can set somebody else free. I can worship in my closet and set people free. I can worship in my church and set my neighbor free. I can worship in the grocery store and set people free, because I'm not in the same bondage those people are. It may look like I'm in the same scenario. Let me break it down to you. Okay, let's put two people in foreclosure. Let's put Paul and Silas also next to them in foreclosure. They appear to be in foreclosure, except the ones that are in foreclosure over here, Paul and Silas, start praising God. Because it may appear a certain way on the outside, but a true worshiper is never bound on the inside. I'm never imprisoned on the inside. I'm never, ever, ever in bondage on the inside. And I can prove it. The one who knows how to worship will never, ever be in bondage. I'll say it this way. The one who worships is not in bondage. That's what's so hard as pastors, when we get up to minister in front of people that we love and are precious, and you're like, whoa, what happened from last Sunday? And you look out and you see them and you want to help them, and you're like, what can I do to change what I've been saying? I can't give you the word anymore. God, help me. Make it more anointed. Do something. Do I need to fast? Do I need to pray? Do I need to... What do I got to do? Let's get people to stop letting the devil counseled out of them every Monday morning and do the word they hear on Sunday morning and worship all week long. Here's your assignment. 10 extra minutes. That's it. Just 10 extra minutes. Some of you are like, 10 minutes? I don't even do no minute. All right, listen. 10 extra minutes outside of church. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. 10 extra minutes. You can do that on the way to work. You can do that with your iPod. Throw in some music and begin to worship God. And tell me if 10 extra minutes doesn't change your life a day. You don't have to turn here, but if you're taking notes, you can write this down, Luke chapter 8. Verse 1, and it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with them, and certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went 7 devils, Joanna the wife of Chuzza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others, which ministered unto him of their substance. And when much people were gathered together and were come to him out of every city, he spoke by a parable. Now, did you see what was said there? Ladies and gentlemen, the entertainer is here. I'm sorry. No, not Derek. I meant the real God. Somebody help me here. He meant that they ministered to him with their substance. They ministered to him with their substance. See, this is the part where people shut him down. And I'm going to tell you right now, the spirit of fear, as long as it's allowed to reign in your finances, you will not see the testimonies that my brother's seeing, that the pastor pastors are seeing, that we're seeing, that some of you are seeing. Why? Because fear will paralyze your finances and it'll stop you from worshiping. What does the enemy want you to do? He wants you to stop worshiping. He wants you to worship ignorantly. He wants you to worship superstitiously. He wants you to worship the unknown God. You know, you throw out your tithe, you throw out your seed, and hope it comes back. Come on, mama needs a new pair of shoes. You know, it's not a gamble, it's not a crapshoot, it's not a roulette wheel. You are putting your seed out with purpose and assignment. Now hear me. They ministered to him with their substance. Which means what? They worshiped him. They worshiped him with their gifts. Every offering that goes by, every bucket that goes by, look at it as a wave. When pastor says we're taking up the offering for tithes and offerings, Sunday morning, whatever, it's a bucket, it's a wave. You want to put something in on every wave, knowing that a harvest comes in on every wave. They minister to him out of their substance. You ready for this? I am never preaching something that I don't live myself. Pastor, I like what a minister friend of ours said. He said, whenever you hear a minister talking about finances, you can tell if they don't give themselves because they got sissy on their voice. They're trying to get you to do something that they don't do. If I didn't think it would affect your giving in a negative way, I'd tell you what we're up to selling nowadays. I was telling Pastor, you know, before we had these meetings, I said, you know, we're going to do love offerings. You know, that's exactly what we've agreed to do. And God, we're not putting pressure on nobody. We're putting pressure on the spirit of poverty. And I'll tell you that thing's broken in here. Something left this church, over this church, this week. Glory to God. You don't have to agree, but it is. It's gone. Don't be part of trying to bring it back because we won't allow it. So, you know, when we first came, we didn't have the expenses we have now. But see, our expenses have grown to do what God's called us to do. We have been asked to do a television broadcast on KGEB, right here, Golden Eagle Broadcasting, Channel 23. It also goes to 50 million homes on Dish Network. So, you know, praise God, you know. I mean, how many of y'all think that crazy-haired, truthful minister should be on TV? Come on, I grew up in the same era. Actually, you were in it a little bit longer than I was, but I came up in the same era where Christian TV used to have good ministers on it. You know, like Dr. Price. I mean, good ministers. You know, like Flo Dollar's good. I'm not dogging any of those. I'm talking about some of that fluff that's out right now. I'm like, are you kidding me? You're the latest telethon poodle jumping through hoops. What is this? I should have had my coffee this morning, I know. But the bottom line is, when I sow, I'm sowing to minister to the Lord. He doesn't need your money. Did you know that? Did you know God doesn't need our money? But he does see where your heart is with it. How can the widow woman give two pennies and give more than anybody else that was given? And we know bunches were given. Now check this out. Jesus had to have been sitting by the bucket. Be thankful we're not doing that in here. But Jesus had to have been sitting by the bucket. Think about this offering. People coming up. This widow woman comes up. Tears in her eyes. Opens up her pouch. Takes the only two pennies she has. Puts them in the offering bucket. And he's watching. That means he just saw what other people were putting in too, because he made a comparison. He said, this woman just gave more than all of you did in ratio, because she gave out of her heart. We have millionaire friends. Listen, you're going to be upset with me when I say this, but the truth is, we have millionaire friends that ask us out to lunch and then make us pay for it. How often do you think we go to lunch with them anymore? And we haven't always, Pastor Hill, been in a position to go to the restaurant we just went to and buy lunch. You know, I got a 17-year-old Goliath that I've got to keep fed. Anybody got a boy that, you know, or just a big woman that's a daughter, you know, that eats a lot? All right. I mean, you know what I'm, they just eat, and it's just, it's normal for them to be fed. And we could have easily fed him at least 2 or 3 meals. We're good stewards with God's money, is what I'm saying. And when a millionaire who's Christian and their gift is on giving, see, that's why Jesus said that woman that gave the 2 mites gave more than all of them. I don't know if I'm getting older or if it's just the lighting in here, but I could have sworn it looked like T.D. Jakes was getting ready to take up the offering back there. All right, come on. It's a compliment. So I just need you to get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Well, I was stupid tonight. What am I just flat out stupid? Hey! Remember, Creflo Dollar's hat, brother, is? We know we're in the end times because the best rapper was white and the best offer is black. Come on, we know we're in the end times. You're welcome, Friday Night Ministry. You're welcome. Now, how many of y'all are ready to minister to the Lord of your substance? Listen, I believe in it so much. If you don't have anything to sow, would you please just put your hand up and ask one of your neighbors? I don't care if you give them a quarter, a dollar. If they know they're supposed to get in on this, God says He gives seed to the sower. That means if somebody in here is wanting to sow, don't hold them back. Let them sow something. I want everybody to sow because I want everybody blessed. Because when you have a $100,000 tax bill taken care of, or somebody blesses you with a house in a recession, or somebody takes care of a $5,000 debt at a hospital, come on, hospitals can be kind of brutal sometimes. I don't know if you know this or not. But God, thank you, Jesus. You want to come and say, Mother? Thank you, Lord, for Brother T.D. James. I thought you'd be bigger than that, man. Thanks for calling during the message. I appreciate you. Nothing but love for you. Can't believe I gave that guy A's in my class. Even without grading his stuff, just because he's one of the hills, I said, you know what, Lord, I'll just give him an A. Amen. He said, amen. Are you ready to worship God? This is what I'm going to ask you to do. Some of you have already made out your offering. That's fine. But when we worship here, just for a brief moment, it doesn't take long. Ask the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to sow? Because He knows what you have need of, and He knows the harvest He can release to you. Your seed releases the increase. Hallelujah. Everything that hath breath, we praise you, Lord. Before Adam even became alive, in Genesis it said that the Lord breathed life. That word translates Spirit of God into him. We see in the Gospels at one time when Jesus is eating with the disciples and He breathed on them. He's breathing the Spirit of God, life on them. We rebuke and renounce the spirit of fear in Jesus' name. We, through our faith, paralyze fear. Do you have a song, Tim? Okay. As they're ministering to the Lord, I want you to minister to Him also. Every head bowed, every eye closed. On any level, you may be in here and you say, I've never asked Jesus to be the Lord of my life, and I want Him to make Him Savior. Or you may say, I'm a born-again child of God. I've prayed the prayer of salvation, but I want to rededicate tonight. I'm not going to make you come down. I just want to see a sign of hands. And when I count to three with the other hands that are lifted, I'm going to ask you to lift your hand with theirs. And I'm going to make a prayer available for you and with you before you leave here. Because I know many of us are leaving here on a different level of glory than we came in. All over this place. One, two, three. Lift your hand if you want prayer. I see that hand. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Let's all pray this together. Oh, God in heaven, I thank you for Jesus. I thank you that he died for me. I thank you that he rose again for me. On the third day, Jesus, come into my heart. Wash me white as snow. Cleanse me. Forgive me. I say with my mouth and believe with all of my heart, Jesus, you are my Lord and you are my Savior. Now, minister to him. Whatever he says for you to do, do it. Glory to God. Let's go ahead and sing. Don't rush through this. This is not worship. Thank you.
God, you are the healer of the Lord. You're not worshiping Him. If you do anything, you're worshiping Him.
the finger coordination of it, like that. A little bit. I'm not anywhere near this man.